welcome you to a special session, our Good Friday session, and we're so glad you're tuning in today. You know, we are all tuning in together today. And as we come together today to remember one of the hallmarks of our Christian faith, we want to welcome you. Would you join me in a word of prayer? God, today we are reminded of Easter week, this weekend. We are reminded of your amazing, amazing grace upon our lives. Lord, today all of us are here because of your amazing grace. Amazing grace that has sustained us, God, through the worst pandemic known to human history. Amazing grace that has sustained us through a year, God, of challenges. And we thank you that you have brought us to this year to be able to celebrate and remember your great grace and your great love through giving your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, to be born and to live and to struggle as a man, to identify with all our hurts and pains and our discouragement, our disappointments, but to overcome. And so, God, we give you this evening. We pray, God, for everything that you're going to do, everything that you're going to speak into us, God, for everything you have for us, we receive. We open our hearts and we open our hands to receive it now. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's continue to worship, shall we?
as they wept, the morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, His blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon Him. One final breath He gave as heaven looked away. The sun
sing. Friday is here, but Sunday is coming. And we need all of you to come out, celebrate God's love right here in People's Church in person. We've got two sessions, 10 a.m., 12 noon. And we only have room for 40 kids in our kids session. So if you haven't received the email, go to our Facebook page, RSVP there. It's first come, first serve. We've got bags ready for your kids, but we need to know how many we need to prepare. So we hope you go to that link, reserve, and see you on Sunday.
Dad.
Good evening, everybody. I'd like to welcome you to our Good Friday session. Now, have you ever wondered why Good Friday was called Good Friday? When it's really all about God getting beat up, right? Scourged, disrespected, flogged, humiliated, and then crucified. Try explaining that to a five-year-old. From a human standpoint, it's really more of the worst and the most cruel, dehumanizing day ever, I think. I did a little survey on my own and randomly asked people, what is Good Friday? And to my amazement, no one really can give a clear answer about it. Someone even said, well, you know, Friday is always good because it precedes the best day of the week, which is Saturday and Sunday. Now, depending on where you are from, Good Friday is celebrated and observed in many different forms, rituals, and ceremonies all around the world. It involves fasting, it involves abstinence, praying, making penance, procession. Now, in the Philippines, they even reenact that whole flogging and nailing of Jesus on the cross. I remember growing up and seeing this every year and just asking my dad, why are they doing this? And the answer was, well, they are trying to make penance for their sins. They're trying to pay for their sins, Phoebe. And I said, why? And my dad says, because they want to be forgiven. They want to be forgiven and feel forgiven. Why? I asked. And then he said, because they want to show God that they're really sorry for what they've done wrong. So they try to hurt themselves. They try to crucify themselves. Now, there is in all of us this thing called guilt that just eats us up inside when we know we have done something wrong. And really, it's something you cannot turn off or ignore forever. Maybe you can numb it for a while. And this guilt that we have, it keeps us restless, it keeps us sleepless, suspicious, paranoid, reactive, and fearful. Now, some people call this guilt as the demons of the soul, or the skeleton in our closets, or the dark shadows in our life. Now, when Jesus died on the cross, he uttered what we know today as the seven last words of Christ in the cross. The final word he declared was the statement, was the word, it is finished. Now, what did he mean by that? What exactly did he mean, it is finished? Now, let's face it. We will all die with unfinished business. The world is filled with unfinished projects, unfinished dreams, and even unfinished mission. The only person ever in history that has ever finished everything he had to do before he died was Jesus Christ. And thank God he did finish it. Thank God he finished everything, right? In fact, on this day, Good Friday, 21 years ago, Jesus was hanging on the cross, and at the end of his suffering, in John chapter 19, the words of Jesus was recorded, and it says this in John 19, 28 and 30. It says, knowing that all of it was now completed, and so that scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, I'm thirsty. And after Jesus was given a drink, he said, it is finished. And with that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Now, this phrase, it is finished, is called the word of victory. It is not a sign of defeat. It is not a surrender, but it is actually called the word of victory. They give him a drink. They gave him a drink, and then he shouted, it is finished. It's done. It's completed. Now, this is the word of victory. Now, throughout history, there have been many memorable words of victory. There are a lot of famous words that have been shouted throughout history as a sign of victory. But these three words, it is finished, these are the most important and most powerful word in history. Nothing compares to these words. It is finished. Jesus shouted it. Now, what's ironic is that when Jesus shouted this in the cross, it is finished, nobody understood what he really meant. Nobody there had the slightest idea what Jesus was trying to say or what Jesus was declaring at that moment. To the Roman soldier, they thought this was like, this radical revolutionary is now done. He's done, right? To the religious leader who actually put him on the cross, they think our competition is finished. To Pilate, the governor, he thought, wow, my political headache is finished. I'm not going to have to worry about this guy anymore. Now, get this, even the disciples had no idea what Jesus was saying. To the followers of Jesus, they did not understand this. And so they were thinking, yeah, right, we're finished. The dream has died. The kingdom isn't here. The Romans haven't been overthrown, and we are finished. And I believe the devil doesn't know. Satan has no idea what Jesus said on the cross. He thought, wow, I won. The Son of God is finished. I have won and I have killed God. See, nobody understood what Jesus was saying when he said it is finished. Jesus did not say I'm finished because he wasn't finished. And we know how the story ends today. But to the listeners, to those who were part of that whole scenario, they had no idea. Even though the disciples know, Jesus told them, I'm going to rise up. They didn't even believe that. They could not even imagine that. Now, when he said it is finished, what exactly was finished? His suffering? Yes. His pain? Yes. The humiliation of dying on the cross like a criminal death? Yes. But there's so much more behind that statement. Now, what I want to do in a few seconds tonight is look at the five things that Jesus meant when he said the word, it is finished. Now, I don't want you to misunderstand what this phrase means, because this, my friend, is a central thought of Christianity, of our faith. This is the central message of our faith. Now, the first thing I need to explain to you is that this phrase, it is finished, is actually just one word in Greek. When Jesus shouted it, he did not shout three words. He did not say, it is finished. No. The phrase, it is finished, in Greek, in the is the word tetelestai, tetelestai. This is a very common Greek word, and in an ancient Greek society, it is basically used everywhere. It had a lot of different meaning. That one word, tetelestai, has a lot of different meaning. In fact, it had five meanings. And guess what? Every one of these five different meanings, Jesus was referring to that when he shouted, tetelestai, when he shouted on the cross, it is finished. Now, in the first meaning, the first place, it was used by servants or employees. If you had a boss and you had been given a job to do and you finished the job, you would go to your boss and say, boss, master, tetelestai. You're saying, I finished the task, the job is done, and the job that you have given me is completed. Now, when Jesus shouted, it is finished, tetelestai, he was telling the Father, Father, I have completed the task. The job is completely done. But it is also a legal term. The judges would use the word tetelestai in the courtroom. When you serve your time for the crime that you have committed, you would come back before the judge and you would bring the paperwork and you would tell the judge, Judge, I have paid for the debt that I owe. Judge, the justice has been served and I've completed my sentence. I did my time. And the judge takes your paper and he stamps it with the word tetelestai. That means justice has been served. Jesus meant that too. When he shouted, it is finished, tetelestai. He's saying, I paid and served and I did my time for their crime, Father. He said, I did your crime and I served for your crime. But it also means an accounting term. It is also used by accountants. When you have paid all your bill, let's say you bought a car and you paid it in full, when the accountants look at your paper, they would stamp in your bill, they would stamp in your paperwork the word tetelestai, meaning that the debt has been paid, your car is paid off. Now when Jesus shouted tetelestai, meaning everything is paid in full, the debt has been canceled, what you owe has been paid in full. Now, I like this part too. It is also a term used by artists. And when an artist is painting a picture, whether it's acrylic or oil or watercolor or charcoal, whatever, and when they finish the piece, and the very last stroke of the brush, when he's about to finish the piece, the masterpiece, on the very last stroke of the brush, when the whole painting is completed, the artist would say, tetelestai, meaning, in other words, the picture is complete. It is finished. There are no more details to deal with. It is all done. The picture is perfect, and the painting, the masterpiece, is finished. Friends, think about that. When Jesus shouted at the cross, it is finished. He's saying no more details. The picture is completely perfect. Finally, the fifth way it was used in Greek, was it was used in the temple. See, Jewish priests, when they went to the temple, when they would offer a sacrifice to God, they would come out after the sacrifice, they would come out and they would say to the people, tetelestai, which means the sacrifice has been accepted. The sacrifice has been made. Now get this. All five of these phrases, the job is completed, justice has been served, the debt has been paid, the picture is finished, and the sacrifice has been made. Jesus is saying all five of this was completed when I said, it is finished, tetelestai. Now this single word, folks, this single word, think about this, sums up Christianity in a nutshell. If you get this one phrase, you will understand how Christianity is different from every other world religion, whether it's Buddhism, Muslim, or Judaism, or any other faith. This one phrase, "it is finished," is what sets Christian apart from any other religious worldview. It is finished. There is nothing more you can do, and there is nothing more you can add. So what did Jesus actually finish on the cross? What did he complete by dying on the cross? What did he accomplish by dying on the cross? The first task that Jesus finished on the cross was he fulfilled what God had promised us. He fulfilled what God has been promising all through the ages. Now, for thousands of years, God had been promising that a Savior, a Messiah, was going to come to the world to forgive and save us from our sins. And for thousands of years, people waited back in the days. Now, not only there were hundreds of promises in the Old Testament, there are 385 prophecies, think about that. Over 380 prophecies, predictions that this is what the Messiah will do. This is what the coming Savior will do. We just celebrated Christmas, the coming of the birth of Christ. What did the angel say? "Unto you is born this day a Savior, who is Christ the Lord," right? When Jesus died on the cross, he fulfilled every one of the promises, and he fulfilled all the predictions and the prophecies that had been made thousands of years ago about what he was going to do. You see, in the Old Testament, we get what we call a partial glimpse of God. And the way I describe it, it's like a sketch of who God is. We partially saw God in the Old Testament. You see a figure, but it was not really clear. The Bible says it was like a shadow. We don't really see it clearly. But when Jesus came, he filled in all the details. He brought in all the living colors of who God is. He painted us the picture of who God is. He completes the picture. And here Jesus is saying, "If you have seen me, you have seen the Father." Here's what Jesus told some people after he'd come back to life, after he was raised on Easter, in Luke chapter 24, verse 44 and 47. He said this, "This is what I told you when I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms." That's the Old Testament. He said, all the stuff that was written about me for thousands of years had been fulfilled. And then he opened up their mind so that they could understand Scripture. And he told them, "This is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance and forgiveness of sin will be preached in his name to all nations. Now, what is he saying there? He's saying, "Guys, I just fulfilled that promise. All the prediction, all the prophecies that has been given in the Old Testament, I have just fulfilled it." And in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20, it says there, all of God's promise had been fulfilled by him. Who is that him? Christ Jesus. Friends, can I say this? There are over 7,000 promises in this book. And the truth is this. We have those promises, and they are all ours to be claimed because of what Jesus has done on the cross. He paid for those promises to be fulfilled in our lives. Now, there's a second thing that Jesus finished for us in the cross. He satisfied God's justice required. He satisfied what God's justice required. Now, God, we know this, he's a loving God. Yes, he is. But he is also a God of justice. God is a God who is always fair. He cannot be unfair because he is perfect. And God is a God of laws. He's the creator, and everything that he's made in this world runs according to laws that work. And I'm glad all the laws that God God made works, right? There's the law of physics, the law of chemistry, the law of mathematics that works every time. And that's why the world turns and the world runs and the universe runs very, very perfectly. But it is also true personally. There are laws, physical laws, spiritual laws, and there are moral laws that God gave. You can read that God gave these moral laws to Moses and to the people of Israel, but it's not just for them. God says, he said, I want you to take this moral laws and I want you to share it to the rest of the world, the whole world, because it is how relationship works. It is how life works. If you follow these laws, you'll be in good standing. You will be okay. See, God gave us this loss, but you and I have two problems with that. One is we cannot keep them. We are completely unable to keep all of God's laws, all of God's perfect laws. We just cannot keep them all the time. Some people keep some of the law sometimes, but honestly, none of us keep all this law all the time because we're not perfect. None of us. Notice what Romans 8:3-4 says. It says, the law of Moses could not save us because of our sinful nature. But God put in effect a different plan to save us. He sent his son in a human body like ours, except that ours are sinful. God destroyed sin's control over us by giving his son as a sacrifice for our sins. Now get this. He did this so that the requirement of the law would be fully accomplished for us who no longer follow our sinful nature, but instead follow the Spirit. So Jesus, the only person who ever followed God's laws completely, gave himself for you and I so that we could offer, so that he could offer us something we could not attain on our own. He is the perfect man, right? So in order for us to make access to God, he gave himself for us. Friends, God knew from the beginning that we could never gain relationship with him by the law. He knew that. The law of Moses could not save us, but he also knew that he had a different way to solve our problem. So the first problem is we're really just unable to keep God's law. Here's the second problem. Justice requires that lawbreakers pay a penalty. If I break the law, there is a penalty. Fairness requires consequences to all of our actions. And friends, this is what Jesus finished on the cross. Jesus did for us what God's justice required from us. He finished what we could not finish so that he could offer us something we could never gain on our own. Now, Hebrews 5:9, this verse on the screen says this. Read that with me. It says, after Jesus finished his work on the cross, he became what? The source of eternal salvation for who? For everyone who obeys him. Get a load of that, man. After he finished the work on the cross, it says he became the source of eternal salvation, not limited salvation, eternal salvation for everyone who obeys. Friends, Jesus is able to do that because Jesus satisfied God's justice. And he did it for me, he did it for you, and he did it for mankind. He offers that to us. In Romans 10:4, he says this. Paul wrote, Christ ended the law so that anyone who believes in him may be right with God. Now notice that phrase, anyone who believes in him. How does this become true in your life? You believe, right? You trust in what Jesus Christ has done for you. And he says, I want to give you what you could not gain on your own. And in Romans 5:18 sums up everything that we've been talking about the last couple of minutes. Here it is in a nutshell. Now notice, read it with me in your outline. It says there, just as one person, Adam, did it wrong and got all of us in trouble, This trouble was what? Sin and death. Another person did it right, Jesus, and got us out of it, got us out of it. But more than just getting us out of trouble, he got us into life. Can you imagine that? So Jesus fulfilled not only God's promise on the cross, but Jesus satisfies God's justice on the cross. This is the third thing that he completed on the cross. He paid off the debt I owe God. He paid the debt that we owe God. You and I owe something to everybody we've ever hurt or offended or sinned against. We owe something to them. But we are also in deeper debt to God. And that's a debt we would never possibly be able to pay on our own. But here's the good news. In Colossians chapter 2, the Bible says this. Verse 14, read that with me. It says, we owe the debt because we've broken God's law. And that debt listed all the rules we have failed to follow. But here's the good news. But God forgave our debt and he canceled our debt. How? By nailing it to the cross. Friends, can you imagine? Just a thought. Maybe let's even dream a little bit. Can you imagine going home tonight and all of a sudden you got a call from your credit card, from your lender, from your mortgage, and they tell you, hey guys, we have decided to cancel all your debt. We're just going to wipe it all out. Your record is wiped out. You're completely forgiven from all your debt, your student loan, your car loan, your house loan, everything forgiven. We're calling it our new Tetelestai program, right? Can you imagine that? Paid in full, you're free. Man, you would jump for joy. Would you like that? Oh yeah, you would like that, right? Would you feel free? Of course you would feel free. You would literally jump for joy for that. You would just be screaming your head off. Friends, can I say this? That is what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross. He paid off the debt that I owe God. Can I say this? That's the reason why when some people worship God, you know, I don't apologize for that, but man, you see some people worship and they are just jumping for joy. They're all out. Why? Because they completely understood what Jesus Christ has done for them. Colossians chapter 1 verse 14 says, God's Son paid the price. God's Son paid the price to free us, which means that our sins are forgiven. Which sins are forgiven? All of them. For all our sins, all of them, every single one of them. Remember, I said this 2 weeks ago. When God forgives, he doesn't forgive you partially. He forgives you completely. Just to have it wiped off, to have your debt paid off by somebody. And friends, that's how amazing God's love and God's grace is. In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 18, read that with me. It says, now that sin have been forgiven, there is no need to offer any more sacrifices. That's what penance is. But you know what the problem is? Our problem is we keep trying to pay for the sins that have already been paid. Wow, we carry the guilt. We go around and like, gosh, why do I still feel not forgiven? Friends, can I remind you? Jesus paid for every single sin you have committed and you will ever commit. It's paid. You don't need to pay for them. And that's good news. I hope you get this. He paid the debt I owe God, and there is nothing more any one of us can do. Now get this, here's the fourth thing Jesus finished. He defeated, and this is a big one, he defeated the fear of death. Now I don't know about you, but the fear of death is a universal fear of everybody. Everybody is afraid of death. We don't want to talk about it. We don't want to even use the word. Have you ever talked to people? Oh, we say like, oh, we don't say he died. What do we say? Oh, he passed. Oh, he moved on. He graduated. Why are we afraid to use the word died or death? Why? Because it's a universal fear. This is a universal fear. But when Jesus was on the cross, he broke that fear of death and the power of death. Read with me Romans 5:17. Notice what it says. The sin of one man, Adam, caused death to rule over us. But all, what is it again? All who received God's wonderful grace, gift of righteousness. That's the gift of grace. What did it say? We live in triumph over sin and death through this one man, Jesus Christ. Now, how did he break the power of sin and death in our lives? Read the next verse in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14 and 15. It says there, Jesus came flesh and blood. That means became like human being by being born in human form. For only as human being could he die. And only by dying, get this, only by dying could he break the power of the devil who had the power of death, right? Only in this way could he deliver those who have lived all their lives a slave to the fear of dying. See, friends, Jesus had to die in order to deliver us from the fear of dying. Why? Because we know he rose again. Let me explain something. If Jesus Christ had not been resurrected, you wouldn't have any idea that there is life after death. We would have not known that. The only reason you and I know that there is life after death is because Jesus Christ resurrected after 3 days. Now, let me just put this in perspective. Friends, nobody else in this world has resurrected from the dead. Now, a lot of times you read books of people who died after a few hours and then they're supposed to have died, but then they came back to life. That's not a resurrection. That's maybe a resuscitation, okay? They went to a coma, and then they slipped, and then they came back to life. Resurrection means you were buried under the ground, or you were buried in the grave, and in 3 days, you came alive. That is a resurrection. You've been dead for 3 days. That's a resurrection. Now get this, nobody else has been resurrected. Resurrection means you've been dead for days. And friends, Jesus is the only man who has lived and died and resurrected after 3 days. Now, there's a fifth reason that Jesus said it is finished. And the fifth task that he has finished is this in the cross. He destroyed Satan's power to control me. Now, this is a big one. And for many of you, probably, Satan doesn't exist. It's a figure of the imagination. There are no demons. There's no dark world. Well, I want to let you know this. If you believe in God, you have to believe in Satan because he does exist. The Bible talks about him. There's stories and incidents in the Bible. There's narratives. Even Jesus encountered the devil, right? So this guy, this Satan guy, is something we can never dismiss. And the Bible says when Jesus died on the cross, he destroyed Satan's power to control us. He did that on the cross. Friends, can I say this, whether you realize it or not, the enemy, the devil, Satan is at work today. And he is, yes, he is controlling lives. In the death of the Son of God on the cross, there's a cosmic battle going on between good and evil. And from a human standpoint, when you look at Jesus and the cross, it looks like evil was winning in that moment. It looks like the devil was winning. It looked like Satan has won the battle. But get this. When Jesus gives up his spirit and he died, when he gave up his spirit and died, Satan thought, I did it. I won. I killed God. But after 3 days, he was surprised. Why? He's back, right? He's back. I will come back, Jesus say. Now on the cross, Jesus cries out and he shouts out, Tetelestai, it is finished. I am not finished. That's not what Jesus said. I'm not finished. He said, it is finished. And in 3 days later, Satan realized, oh my good word, I am finished. Because the guy I thought I killed came back to life. Now let me be frank with you. If you do not know Jesus Christ, if you don't have his spirit in your life, you are flat out powerless against Satan's traps and tricks. You don't have any power at all against him. You have no power against his maneuver, his strategy, and even his tactics in your life. You have no power against evil if you don't have God's Spirit in your life. Now, the Bible says, if you have God's Spirit, we know this, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. But if you don't have any of that power in you, you will be powerless, right, to the dark forces of this world. A few years ago, I used to tell my kids, you know, stay away from those things, you know, there's a lot of shows on television that talks about darkness and evil forces and the supernatural, all those things. And it actually is very scary, right? And so Satan comes and uses those to inflict fear in our lives, to inflict imaginations and fear in our thoughts. Now, how does Satan manipulate you? Here, think about this. He manipulates you through your thoughts. He manipulates you through suggestions. And his two favorite ways in manipulating you is temptation and condemnation. Now, what does he do when he tempts you? He goes something like this. He tempts you with something that you know is wrong and you know it's going to destroy you. Or maybe you think, you know, okay, I'm just going to do this one time. This is how we say, you know what? No one's watching. It's no big deal. Go ahead, do it. Your wife is not watching. Your husband's not watching. No one can see. No one is ever going to find out. What is it doing? He is minimizing the temptation. And guess what happened? The moment you do it, the moment you fall, guess that word we were talking about? That guilt begins to come in. And what does he do now? He doesn't minimize the guilt. He maximizes the guilt. He goes, oh my gosh, shame on you. You've done that? Oh my goodness, you call yourself a Christian? Oh my gosh, you call yourself a church leader? Well, God's never going to forgive you, and guess what? Everyone's going to find out. And when everybody's going to find out, that's it. That's the end of you. And he goes on and on and on. He minimizes the temptation, but he maximizes the consequences and the guilt. See, temptation and condemnation. Now notice what Jesus did in this verse in your outline. Read that with me. It says, Jesus destroyed first the power of temptation. Did you get that? Jesus destroyed first the power of temptation. And then in Colossians 1:13, it says, God has freed us from the power of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of his dear son. He destroys that power, folks. Secondly, he destroys Satan's power to accuse us. Satan cannot condemn you anymore. Why? Because you are completely forgiven. And friends, can I say this? If God's forgiven you, God likes you, and you like God, Satan's got a problem. Colossians 2:15 says, God took away Satan's power to accuse you of sin. Get a load of that. So for those of you who are walking around with guilt and shame, and you know you ask God for forgiveness, I want to let you know that is, God says you don't have to walk with your heads bowed. You don't have to hide. You don't have to go in seclusion, because God took away Satan's power to accuse you of sin. He cannot accuse you anymore, my friend. And then keep reading, it says, and he openly displays the whole world's Christ. He openly displays the whole world's Christ triumph at the cross, where your sins, now get this last phrase, where your sins were all taken away. Friends, the cross was God's final blow to evil. The cross was God's final blow to Satan's tactic and control in our life. He didn't even know what was going on. He lost his power. You say, well, why does it seem like, Pastor Phoebe, Satan's got all the power today? Satan is living on borrowed time, my friend. His days are numbered. And if you know scripture, it is a very, very big day for Satan when that day comes, right? He's going to be overthrown. Now, if you have accepted God's spirit in your life inside you, Satan has power that you yield to him. Only if you yield to him. He doesn't have power over you if you don't yield it. But get this. If you yield to him, guess what? He's got you. Now, how do you yield to Satan? One, through fear. He likes to scare you. He likes to frighten you. He wants to talk negativity in your mind. That yields power to Satan. And that's the reason why, can I say this? Hey, young people, even adults, I know some of you are like, oh, I want to watch a scary movie. Okay, suspense, that's fine. But evil movie, dark movies, stay away from that. You are opening your mind and your thoughts to the suggestion of fear. He yields, he deals with you, he attacks you through fear. You also yield back to him when there is bitterness in your heart, through anxiety, through giving in to temptation, through depression. That's yielding into the darkness. Yeah. You can yield power to Satan, friends, but he doesn't have any power over you unless you yield it to him, because Jesus Christ destroyed his power already in the cross. Okay, let me summarize this. When Jesus died on the cross and he says, "Tetelestai," it is finished, he's saying this to you. I fulfilled all of God's promises. Now it's yours. I satisfy God's judgment so you don't have to pay. You know, you don't have to go to prison. You are free. I paid off the debt you owed God. You are debt free. You do not need to walk around with fear or with guilt or with shame. And then he said this, you don't have to fear death anymore. I defeated the fear of death. You don't have to be afraid. You don't have to be afraid to die. As a matter of fact, when that moment comes, you can look up to God and say, God, take me home. And then he said, you do not have to fear Satan or his control in your life, because I destroyed him. Friends, all of these benefits are potentially yours, but they're not yours yet. They're potentially yours. You just need to accept it. You need to accept these five benefits in your life. And here's the problem. Many people know that. Many people know, can talk about that, can argue about that, can discuss about what Jesus Christ done in the cross. But the question I want to ask you is this. Have you accepted that? Friends, there is nothing more you can do. No rituals, no traditions, no nothing. You cannot add anything to what Jesus Christ has done. See, what I'm saying to you this evening is this. The difference between Christianity and the other world religion is this. Every other faith is wanting to do something. All the other religion have a list of do's and don'ts in order for you to make it to God. And even the secular religion have their do's and don'ts. But get this, when it comes to a relationship with Christ, the word is done. If you remember the diagram I asked you to draw last Sunday, Remember, men on one side with the word do, and God on the other side with the word done. Jesus in the middle, bridging that gap. And Jesus said, it is complete. The bridge is complete. It is finished. Tetelestai. There is nothing left for you to do. And all you need to do at this point right now is accept it. There is nothing for you to do. Let's bow our heads. Would you pray this simple prayer in humility and honesty and authenticity to God? Say, actually, it doesn't matter what words you say, but it's a matter of the heart. Say something like this. Say, Jesus Christ, I thank you for dying for me. Say that in your mind. Whisper it in your breath and mean it in your heart. Say, Jesus Christ, thank you for dying for me. Thank you that you paid off the debt that I owed God. Thank you that you satisfied justice. Thank you that you have set me free. I know it's not fair for me to go free, but I am thankful. I should have paid for my sin, but you paid it for me, God, Jesus. You satisfied God's justice. And Jesus, thank you for keeping your promise. God, thank you for sending a Savior to earth, because I certainly cannot save myself. And Jesus, thank you for defeating the fear of death, that I can now walk with freedom and confidence, that I can know that there is life after death because you came back to life. And Lord, most of all, I thank you that you destroyed Satan's power to control my life and to control me. I don't want to be controlled by the evil, by the devil. I want to be controlled by your Spirit. So as much as I know how, God, I humbly say, I believe in you, Jesus. I believe in what you've done for me. And I believe in all that you have given me in the cross. I accept your gift, and I want to spend the rest of my life just getting to know you and learning to love you and being forever grateful for what you have done for me. Thank you that you have loved me first, even before I was away from you, even before I was your enemy. You have loved me first, and I humbly pray this in your name. Amen. Wow, isn't that amazing? You know, I was studying this and I could not help. It's a good reminder. I guess Good Friday is really a good reminder for us for what Jesus Christ has done for you and me in the cross. And I'd like to say this, regardless of where you are in your spiritual journey, I hope that you have really taken and embraced, and maybe it's a lot of information, take a moment this tonight or somehow this weekend and silence yourself and sort of like rethink and really recollect and I would say, God, I pray that let this be real in my life. Let me really fully understand this. So my prayer is this, that I pray that the God who gave you his best will begin to do his work in your life. And here's what I know. For those of you who have committed your life to Jesus Christ, and you're kind of like, I don't know, I'm wishy-washy, I still have this guilt, I feel like I'm still falling, I want to let you know this. Don't give up. Hang in there. What Jesus Christ has done on the cross will finish its work in your life. I always hang on this verse, what Paul said, he who has begun a good work in our lives will finish it and bring it into completion. May God bless you. And I'd like to say this again. I'd like to remind you, on Sunday, we'll see you online and we'll see you on site to rejoice and celebrate Easter. Again, please don't forget to sign up. We love to have you here, except we still want to control the crowd. And so please RSVP. And if you don't have a way of RSVPing or you don't have a computer, give us a call. Give our secretary a call and let them know, hey, I'm going to be there on Sunday. I'm bringing my 3 kids, my 2 kids, my grandchildren. Let us know that. We have a children's program. We're going to have 2 sessions, one at 10 o'clock and one at 12 o'clock. So you have a choice. I think the first session is filling up very fast. So please call and make your reservation. I would love to see you here. And yes, we go in with all the protocols. We wear our mask, we social distancing, we love each other through our waves and our imaginary hugs and our elbows or our feet. But I would love to have you here this Sunday. May God bless you, and I'll see you on Sunday. I love you all.
Thank you for joining us on this special Good Friday session. We hope you were encouraged. We know we were. You know, friends, we've got an exciting weekend planned ahead, and we hope you get to join us this weekend, whether live or in person, in our live session. We've got two sessions coming up, and you already know that. We let you know that. So again, if you haven't gotten a chance to RSVP, we don't know if there's any room left in the kids session, but you're more than welcome to RSVP. If there's still room, we would love to connect with you and see you on this Easter session. Before we close, would you join me in a word of prayer? Let's pray. God, we thank you for sending your son Jesus to show us your lavish love upon all of us. And yes, God, we thank you because nothing can keep you and nothing can keep us from your great and awesome love. Today, Lord, as we close our time together, we pray that you would help us to hear and to take the words that we heard today and to apply it in our lives. Our prayer, Lord, is always help us not just to be hearers of your word, but help us to be doers of your word. Lord, we thank you that you've given us this weekend to thank you and to reflect and to connect. So God, as we dismiss and as we face this coming weekend, Lord, we pray that you would be with us. Help us to be a blessing to people around us, and help us to remember, God, that you are always near. We thank you, Lord, for your word, and thank you for speaking to us tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for joining us on our beautiful, special Good Friday session. We hope to see you on Sunday in our Easter session. God bless you. Have a wonderful weekend.